Sister Rodeline and Buena. And our guest for today is Brother Lord Rolly Rata. And we will be tackling the Bible traditions and, of course, the magisterium. But before we start our program, let me request Brother Lord to lead a prayer for us.
Thank you, Sister Rodeline. Let us all bow down our heads in prayer. In the name of the Father, the Son, of the Holy Spirit, amen. Lord God, thank you for giving us another opportunity in which we will be talking about your doctrines, your faith, your revealed truths. Thank you, Lord, for the interest of our audience, and bless us so that everything that we'll be talking tonight or today will become very beneficial to everybody, and will help others who are not yet Catholics to consider the truths of the Catholic religion so that they will also be part of the one fold under the one shepherd. All of this we ask and pray through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. In the name of the Father, the Son, of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Brother Lord, welcome to our Catholic faith. And again, it is, of course, a great pleasure of mine to have you as our guest for tonight.
Thank you.
Now, since we are discussing about the Bible, can I ask you to give us a brief history of how the Bible came to be?
That is a very nice request, Sister Rodeline. My brothers and sisters, before going on to the details about the Bible and its history, let us discuss first the sources of revelation. We as Catholics do not believe that the Bible is the only source of doctrine. In fact, the Bible itself does not claim that it is the sole rule of faith. The Bible says in John 21 verse 25, that not everything that Jesus did were written in the Bible. That's also very clear in 2 John chapter 1, verse 12, and 3 John, verse 13. So, my brothers and sisters, in this episode tonight, we will be discussing about the Bible, tradition, and magisterium. And regarding the request of Sister Rodeline about the Bible is not a book that was thrown by the angels in the ancient times and were caught by different holy men or holy women. The Bible, it was not something like this before. The materials on which the Word of God were written in the ancient times were not the same paper as we have today. Those were the manuscripts made of scrolls from papyrus and from other fragile materials which did not pass the test of time because they have already disintegrated after the passage of many years. Although, thanks be to God, they have been copied over and over again from different materials to other writing materials. And so, the Bible basically is a collection of books on which were written the inspired Word of God. These parts are the Old Testament and the New Testament. The Old Testament is composed of 46 books, and the New Testament is composed of 27 books. The writings of the Old Testament were written before the coming of Christ. The writings of the New Testament were written after the ascension of Christ. And the first book of the Old Testament, which we call Genesis, was written around 1250 BC by a holy man whom we call Moses. And the last book of the Old Testament, which is the book of the second Maccabees, was written around 100 BC before the coming of Christ. The first book of the New Testament is the book of Mark, and it was written around 50 AD, and the last book, Revelation, was written around 98 AD. So basically, there has passed 1300 years for the Bible to have been completed as to its whole parts, although they have not yet been compiled into one book before the passage of 300 years. The whole Bible was compiled in the year 382 AD under the auspices of Pope Damasus I, who was the Pope at that time. And he ordered, thank you, brother, and he ordered Saint Jerome, who was a very erudite scholar, a Bible scholar, and who translated the original writings from Hebrew, Aramaic, and Greek into Latin. And the Vulgate, which means common Latin, Latin Vulgate. The common Latin in those days was used as the new translation for the Bible, for the common people to understand it. And the Bible before 382 AD was not yet compiled into one book. That means it could not yet be called the Bible, because the word Bible means a collection of books, library, or book of books. So for 349 years, or 350 years, more or less, the church, the Christian church, did not yet have any complete Bible. But how did the people in those days know the teachings of the Lord Jesus Christ? How did they know every detail of the doctrines that were delivered by the apostles? It was by means of the magisterium of the church that has never erred in the preservation of these doctrines. Now, according to the Bible, as I have said in the previous video, in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 15, Saint Paul said, "Hold fast to the traditions which you have been taught by us, either by word of mouth or by letter." That means that there have been two ways by which the gospel was handed down to us by the apostles to the church: by preaching orally and by writing. The writing is what we call the Bible, and the preaching, the oral teachings, are what we call tradition. Now, tradition was written after the passage of many years. First, by the church fathers. Second, by the decrees of popes and councils. Third, by the books of the liturgy. And fourth, by our catechisms. This catechism which we use today is the Catechism of the Catholic Church, the second universal catechism published by the Church after the first catechism that was published around 1560s by Pope St. Pius V. So, the two sources of revelation, as I have already mentioned, are the Bible and tradition. That is why we as Catholics never subscribed to the doctrine of sola scriptura, which was the number one article used by Luther in objecting against the church's doctrines. He said that aside from sola fide, sola scriptura is one of the bulwarks of Protestantism. So we never subscribe to that, because never once in the history of the church did any priest in the Catholic Church say that the Bible is the only rule of faith. You can never see that or read any statement such as that in the writings of the Holy Fathers. So I think that covers basically the essential teachings about our sources of revelation.
All right. Now, to follow that up, since you mentioned, Brother Lord, that, well, it took more than 300 years for the council to compile the whole Bible, which is what we actually use today. Is it really enough or no? Can we really trust the Bible on, you know, as a source of our doctrines as the Catholic Church?
Yes, absolutely yes, Sister Rodelin, because that is very evident, first of all, in the writings of the Bible itself. We can read in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16, according to St. Paul, Timothy, let me read to you this passage of the scripture. All scripture inspired of God is profitable to teach, reprove, and correct, and to instruct in justice. So, all scripture is inspired of God. So, the Bible is inspired of God, therefore it is reliable. But some people would say, oh, that is very illogical. You are chasing after your own tail. Just because the book claims its inspiration, then can we logically also prove that that book is reliable? Mm-hmm. What about the Quran? The Quran also claims that it is the word of God, the Vedas, the Sutras, and many other sacred writings of the different religions around the world. How can we say that the Bible is really reliable and the only infallible book in the world? Well, the Bible is always reliable because it is testified by different evidences or pieces of evidence. First of all, regarding the teachings or regarding the truths as that we can gather from history, from archaeology, and from the different sciences, there have been new discoveries already that have proved the reliability and truthfulness of the details in the Bible. There's also the what we call as the Dead Sea Scrolls. The Dead Sea Scrolls are very accurate in terms of of what is written in the Bible. For example, in the four caves of Qumran, there's a cave there in which we can find the book of Isaiah. And the book of Isaiah found in Qumran was written before the time of Christ. And the very words of Isaiah were exactly the same as the words that we find in our Isaiah in our own Bibles today. That means that the Bible was never tampered. It was preserved from any human tinkering after the passage of many years. Why is that so? We rely on the Holy Spirit for that. Now, that proves that the very words of the prophecy of Isaiah, which says that the Redeemer that would come would suffer very much, and we can even say that the details written by the prophet Isaiah were so graphic as if he were looking at a screen what would happen in the future. So the fulfilled prophecies in the Bible are very clear proofs and very strong evidences that the Bible is a very reliable book. Aside from that, the witnesses also of the Bible, who were the early Christians, the apostles, they were all willing to die just to attest to the fact that Jesus Christ was risen from the dead. Now, the fact that Jesus really rose from the dead, and it was testified by many early Christians who died, who never loved their lives to death, just to fight for what they believe was true or is true. So that is really a strong indication that they never lied. No man will die for a lie. I can say that any person who is willing to die for a lie is an insane person. So if all the apostles were willing to die, and in fact majority of them died, only one did not die by cruel death, he died by natural death, and that was Saint John. If majority of them died by martyrdom, just to prove that Jesus Christ really rose from the dead, that means that everything that Jesus told us is reliable. And Jesus Christ's word proves and confirms the truth of the scriptures. He said in John chapter 10, verse 35, the scripture cannot be broken. That is already a strong indication from the words of our Lord Jesus Christ himself, a confirmation that the Bible is infallible and therefore is reliable. Now, going also to different ways of proving the reliability of the Bible, one proof is by means of the miracles. Miracles are the works of God testifying to the reliability or the faithfulness of the words of somebody who witnesses to that something, to that message. God cannot attest to lie. God cannot approve anything that is false. Therefore, God cannot witness a certain message by means of a miracle if that message is not true. Now, if there is a raising from the dead, if a dead rises from the dead, if a dead person becomes alive again just by being exposed to a certain relic of a saint, that is very clear. It was God who made him rise from the dead. Therefore, the belief, the doctrine behind the religion or the religion of that person who was risen from the dead must be true. And that's the Catholic religion. There are many documented instances in which many people who were dead, long dead in fact, have risen back to life just because of the intercession of many saints. And I think it is not the right time to discuss everything about that.
Now, speaking of the reliability of the Holy Bible, I noticed that many versions have come up over the past years. And you mentioned earlier the original Bible that was compiled by the Council was made up of 46 Old Testament books and 27 New Testament books. But I noticed that some Bibles nowadays don't have those complete numbers. So how can we be assured that the Bible that we are reading now is reliable, is a reliable yes. source of our doctrine?
That is a very nice question, Sister Rodeline. This is the English translation of the very first official Bible of the Catholic Church, which we call as the Douay-Rheims version. The English translation of the Latin Vulgate. The New Testament was published in 1582. The Old Testament, together with the New Testament, was published in 1609. So 2 years before the King James Version appeared. How can we be sure that this Bible, the number of this Bible, is exact, no more, no less, is exact, unreliable, faithful, and how can we say that the Bible of the Protestants, which contains only 66 books, is not reliable, their canon of the Bible? Now, we have to trust the authority of the church in that matter, because it was the church who wrote, in the first place, the Bible, because the apostles were all parts of the one church. And it was also the church who gathered the different manuscripts in the ancient times and decided the number of the books that were to be part of the Bible. And then it was also the church who assures us that the copies that we have of the Bible are exact copies of the originals, because the originals have long perished already. In fact, we cannot anymore find any original manuscript now. Many of them have been burned by pagans, by the pagan authorities, and many of them have been burned also by the Christians, because they were afraid that these scriptures might be profaned by these pagan soldiers or pagan authorities. So they burned them themselves. So the testimony of the church must be relied upon. We have to remember that Jesus assured the infallibility of the church. He said in Matthew 16 verse 18, "I tell you, Peter, you are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against my church." That means that everything that is asserted by the church is de facto asserted by the Holy Spirit himself. Now, the church has proved, has confirmed, and has decided that the Bible must contain 46 books in the Old Testament, 37 books in the New Testament. It was decided by the Synod of Rome in 382, confirmed by another council in 393, in Hippo, and then 397 in Carthage, and asserted by and decreed itself by the Council of Trent, Ecumenical Council of Trent, in 1546. So, it has been dogmatized already. The church says that it is the Bible. It is the complete Bible. It does not contain less or more. So, we have to rely on the church. Now, if we question the authority of the church in deciding the canon of the Bible, we are, in effect, questioning the very words of Christ himself. And the very Bible, we are very questioning the very Bible that is believed by these Protestant heretics, separated brethren. So, I think that's the basic answer for that.
Okay. Thank you for that, Brother Lord. Now, so, since you already mentioned the reliability of the Holy Bible as the source of our doctrines, and of course, reiterated and emphasized the infallibility of the church, which actually compiled the Bible, is it enough to, because most people actually just read the Bible by themselves, right? Is it enough to read only the Bible and interpret it for ourselves?
Excuse me. Excuse me, my brothers. That is a very nice question, Sister Rodeline. We have to read the words of the first pope himself, who was Saint Peter. He said in 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 20, it says here, understanding first that no prophecy of Scripture is made by private interpretation. See? So the Bible is not to be privately interpreted. Why? We can read an instance in the Bible in which a eunuch was reading the scripture, the Old Testament scripture, which was the writing of the prophet Isaiah in Acts chapter 8, verse 29 to 31. He was reading the prophet Isaiah while riding on his while boarding his, what do you call that one?
Chariot.
Then the Holy Spirit told Philip, go to that eunuch and then tell him what I want you to tell him. Then when Philip went to the eunuch, he said to the eunuch, do you understand what you are reading? The eunuch said, how can I understand if nobody teaches me? See? How can I understand if nobody teaches me? Implying that there must be a teacher in understanding the teachings of the Bible. That is very clear in Hebrews chapter 5, verse 12 to 13. There must be teachers among you. In fact, that's very clear also in James chapter 3, verse 1. Let not be many teachers among you, for we teachers have to be subjected to stricter judgment. So there must be a teacher in the church. Now, if you are reading your own Bible, understanding it in your own way, that is very dangerous. Because according to 2nd, let me read to you this part of scripture, 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 16, there's a very stern warning by St. Peter himself, who said here, also in all his epistles, Paul, he's speaking of Paul, speaking in them of these things in which are certain things hard to be understood, which the unlearned and unstable rest as they do also the other scriptures to their own destruction. The unlearned, what does it mean? Meaning, those people who have never been taught by the authorities of the church, or if they have been taught, but they did not follow the teachings of the church, if they rest the Bible to their own interpretation, they are subjecting themselves to eternal damnation. And that is very, very, a very hard warning. So, the Bible is not to be privately interpreted. So, if it is not to be privately interpreted, who will then interpret the Bible? It is the church. That is why the Bible says that the pillar and the ground of the truth is the church. 1 Timothy 3:15. Now, if the Bible had been the sole authority in the church, there would have been no authority for 300 years, because the Bible was not yet available as it is.
Yes.
in those days.
Good point there, Brother Lord. Now, earlier on you mentioned about the magisterium. Can you briefly explain to us, especially those who are not really that well versed with our church's terminologies, what is the magisterium, and what is it about?
Thank you, Sister Rodeline. The magisterium is the teaching body of the church. It is composed of the Pope and all Catholic bishops united with him. The magisterium decides in controversies about doctrine and the issues in the church also. So the magisterium is the speaker, the spokesperson, the mouthpiece, so to speak, of Christ himself.
Okay. Now, to follow that, why is our church, why is the Catholic Church reliant on tradition and on the magisterium?
That is a very nice question, Sister. The church relies on tradition because it's very clear in the Bible, and also very clear in tradition itself. What is tradition, first of all?
Such as?
Tradition refers to the body of truths preached orally by the apostles and handed down by the church through the ages until today. It was not altered, never was it added, and never was it subtracted. Tradition, since it was first handed down orally, it found its way into writings. In the writings, first of all, as I have said, of the fathers of the church, in the writings of the decrees of popes and councils, books of the liturgy, and our catechism. So, basically, tradition is the life, teaching, and worship of the church. Everything that the church teaches came from tradition. Mm-hmm. And part of that big tradition was written in the Bible. Mm-hmm. So, before the first book of the New Testament was written, tradition had already been there. Because when Jesus Christ was about to ascend back to the Father, he said to the apostles in Mark 16 verse 15, "Go to the whole world and preach the gospel." Jesus did not say, "Go to the whole world and distribute your own Bibles to different schools, orphanages, universities, or anything such as that." So, the very first mode of transmission was preaching, oral tradition. And so the writings of tradition were written after the lapse of many years. And we can, of course, rely on the unchangeability of tradition because of the presence of the Holy Spirit who abides in the church without break, without day off, until the second coming.
Now, following that, how can we really know that what we believe is authentically sourced from sacred tradition itself?
First of all, I forgot to mention first the scripture that talks about tradition. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 15, "My brethren, stand fast and hold the traditions which you have learned, whether by word of mouth or by letter." And in 2 Thessalonians 3, verse 6, St. Paul said, "And we charge you, brethren, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you withdraw yourselves from every brother walking disorderly and not according to the tradition which they have received of us." So, if a person comes to you in your house and then he rejects tradition, so, your response must be, according to the command of the apostle himself, withdraw yourself from him. In other words, you must never cling to any of his teachings. You must right away reject everything that he says as a whole, because he is rejecting tradition, which is the original source of Christ's teachings. The Bible confirms the presence of tradition. The Bible confirms that tradition was ahead of itself, of the Bible, and the earliest Christians, after the time of the apostles, they all believed in tradition. I have heard a book which contains the quotations of the early church fathers talking about tradition. Let me read to you this one. Page 34. Here. Let me read to you the writing of Saint Irenaeus, who was a disciple of Polycarp, was also a disciple of Saint John the Apostle. He said in year 189 in his book Against Heresies, "The universal church, moreover, through the whole world, has received this tradition from the apostles." So he was talking about tradition. In the writing also of Tertullian, in his book, The Prescription of Heretics, in the year 200 AD, he said, "For wherever both the true Christian rule and faith shall be shown to be, there will be the true scriptures and the true expositions of all the true Christian traditions." And also, in the writing of Saint Jerome, who was a well-known, the greatest biblical scholar in his time, he said, "Do you not know that the laying on of hands after baptism, which means confirmation, and then the invocation of the Holy Spirit, is a custom of the churches, a practice of the churches? Do you demand scripture proof? You may find it in the Acts of the Apostles. And even if it did not rest on the authority of the scripture, the consensus of the whole world in this respect would have the force of the written law. For many other observances of the churches, which are due to tradition, have acquired the authority of the written law." So he was in effect saying that if you cannot find a certain practice of the church in the scriptures or in the Bible, that doesn't automatically mean that it's not true. If that is found in tradition, meaning if all the churches in the world within the Catholic Church do the same thing or believe in the same thing, that means that was part of the original deposit of faith. Tradition handed down from age to age since the time of the apostles. So, tradition is clear in tradition itself, in the Bible, and in the different standard references also. Even encyclopedias, other books confirm that the earliest Christians really practice what we practice today.
Alright. So, now, for my last question, we've actually encountered a lot of people who have claimed that, of course, their interpretation of the Bible is the correct interpretation, and thus rejecting the Bible itself,
yes.
Just basing it on what you have discussed so far. Now, what is really the consequence of believing only in the Bible and rejecting the tradition and the magisterium of our Catholic Church?
The clear consequence is erroneous doctrines. Why? Because first of all, when the Church decided what books were to be in the Bible, the Church based its decision on the apostolic tradition. Now, if you are rejecting the apostolic tradition, you are also rejecting its effect, which is the Bible. You're rejecting the cause of the Bible. So automatically, you are already rejecting the confirmation of the truths of the Bible. Now, you will end up in wrong doctrines. Now, that's very clear in our Catechism, paragraph 120, CCC. "It was by the apostolic tradition that the Church discerned which writings are to be included in the list of the sacred books." And also, we can read in the same Catechism, in paragraph 113, Catechism of the Catholic Church, "Read the scripture within the living tradition of the whole church." So our interpretation of the Bible must take into consideration the analogy of faith, meaning whatever we read in the Bible must be interpreted within the boundaries of tradition. We must not go beyond any formal teaching of the church. So, for example, if you read the Bible and then there's an understanding that comes out, you think that, oh, Christ is not God because it says here, He is man. Now, tradition says He is God. Therefore, you are wrong in your understanding. You must ask, what is the real meaning of this part of the scripture? Now, if you are saying, oh, this is true because it is scripture, your tradition contradicts the scripture. I must rely on scripture. Now, we have to understand that the scripture is not plain in everything that it says. In Matthew 24, verse 15, Jesus Christ said, he who reads, let him understand its meaning. So, the Bible still has to be interpreted. Now, if you are saying that your interpretation of the Bible is correct and you are rejecting tradition, you are just like saying, I am rejecting everything that the apostles preached because I only rely on what they wrote. But the truth is, you are not understanding what they wrote. So, the clear consequence of rejecting tradition and the church magisterium is heresy. Heresies are heresies, schisms, apostasies. So, very terrible. And we have to remember, even the King James Version says it in Galatians 5, verse 20, heresy can bar you from entering the kingdom of God. So heresy is a very grave, mortal sin. That is an insult to the divinity and the truthfulness of God. I remember the word of Saint Padre Pio who said, the greatest insult to divinity is heresy. Why? Because heresy, in subscribing to heresy, you are directly contradicting the nature of God himself, who said in John 14, verse 6, I am the truth. So, if Christ didn't say, I have the truth, he said, I am the truth. If you are believing in a heresy, you are rejecting directly Jesus Christ himself.
Which is the truth.
And if you're loyal to the truth, you are loyal directly to Christ. Mm-hmm. So that's the purpose of defending the faith. That's why St. Thomas Aquinas said, the greatest act of charity is preaching the truth. Why? Because you are benefiting the soul, not only the body. If you are feeding the poor, feeding the hungry, giving drink to the thirsty, helping the poor, giving alms to the poor, you are only helping their bodies. But if you preach the gospel to the poor, if you preach the truth to everyone, you are doing the greatest act of charity. Because even if they die because of hunger, even if they die because of lack of material needs, but they will end up in heaven because you have already sown the seeds of truth in their souls.
That's a very good point there, Brother Lord. Now, let's take some questions from our audience.
Okay.
Does anyone have any questions from our audience?
Starting from
Brother
Richard.
Brother Richard.
Good evening to our viewers. Good afternoon. What time
they are in
our program. I am Richard Garsuta. The Christianity of history is not Protestantism. To be deep in history is to cease to be a Protestant. If you undermine the Catholic Church, you undermine the Bible. The Bible is a Catholic book that is written by John Henry Cardinal Newman, a Catholic convert. Now, my question is, who invented the printing? Second, who invented the printing press and what first book ever printed? Next is, who holds the original manuscript of the Bible? Did they preserve this?
Yes. Thank you, Brother Richard, for your very intelligent questions.
Yes, it's a very interesting question.
Very interesting ones.
Well, series of questions, that is.
The answer to that is, the printing press was invented by Johannes Gutenberg in 1456, if I'm not mistaken, of the year. And the very first book that was printed was the Bible, the Latin Vulgate. And what was your next question, brother? Who preserved the original manuscripts?
Yes.
As I have said a while ago, The original manuscripts, meaning those very papers or papyrus that were written by the sacred writers themselves, have already been lost for a long time. But the copies of those scriptures, the earliest copies, are still preserved, have still been preserved until today. Now, the original, the complete manuscripts that we have today are what we call as the codices, the Codex Vaticanus, the Codex Sinaiticus, and the Codex Alexandrinus. The Codex Vaticanus is preserved by the Vatican until today in the Vatican Museum. The Codex Sinaiticus was found in Sinai, and the Codex Alexandrinus was found also in Alexandria, Egypt. But these Alexandrinus and Sinaiticus are not anymore in their respective places. They are now in the British Museum and the Washington Museum in America. I forgot the exact place. So basically, it is not anymore the Catholic Church who possesses all the ancient manuscripts today, because these manuscripts have been already bought by the great museums in the world, because they guaranteed its preservation. And that is a charitable act also of the Catholic Church, because the Catholic Church, although it is the original and the true owner of the manuscripts, it just allowed these manuscripts to be preserved by people who are really interested in ancient relics, in the in the patrimonies of the ancient times. Mm-hmm. So, I think that is, excuse me, that is a wise act of the Catholic Church in allowing these manuscripts to be kept in the museums of the great museums of the world, not under her auspices.
Mm. Okay. Is very unselfish of our church,
yes.
And which also proves that anyone is actually welcome,
yes,
to view such manuscripts, and which also contradicts the hearsays that we've been hearing from skeptics that the Catholic Church actually keeps secrets. Now, let's take some more questions from our respected brother in the Catholic Faith Defender, Brother Tirso. Do you have questions for Brother Lord?
Okay, thank you very much,
Sister Rodeline.
I have a very important question to our speaker, Brother Lord Rilurata. In the Bible, there are inconsistencies. There are contradictions. Specifically, in Psalm chapter 90, verse 2, it says, "Before the mountains were born, before the earth or the world came to birth, you were God from all eternity and forever." In other words, God has no beginning and no end. Whereas in Revelation chapter 22 verse 18, it says, verse 12 I should say, it sees her. God says, "I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end." So it appears that there are contradictions or inconsistencies in the Bible. In one book it says, God has no beginning and no end. Whereas in Revelation, it says, I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. Why is it that in one book, it says that God has no beginning and no end? Whereas in other book, he is the beginning, the Alpha and the Omega, and the end. Why is it?
Okay.
How would you reconcile that contradictions, Mr. Speaker?
Thank you, Brother Teresa, for such a very interesting question and a very nice one also. What was the last verse that you cited, brothers? Revelation?
Revelation chapter 22, verse 18.
Okay.
Verse 12, I should say.
Revelation 22:12.
I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. So God has beginning and end. Whereas in Psalm
90, he has no beginning, has no end.
Verse 2,
no beginning
God has no beginning and no end.
Yes. Well, the Bible doesn't contain any contradiction because the Holy Spirit is the author of the entire Bible because it is inspired by the Holy Spirit, as we have already said. Now, about that verse that you have cited, brothers, in Psalms chapter 90, verse 2, before the mountains were brought forth, ever since before the creation of the world, from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. Meaning, God has no beginning and has no end. Then, in Revelation also, God says, Revelation 20, verse 12, I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. Now, these two verses do not talk about the same thing. Why? Psalms 90 verse 2 talks about the essence of God Himself. Meaning, God in His divine nature has no beginning and has no end. Otherwise, He is not God. In Revelation chapter 22 verse 12, which says that God is the Alpha and the Omega, or the beginning and the end, He is talking about His relation to the world itself. Meaning, He is the beginning of this world and the end of this world. Implying that He is the creator of the world and He is also the one who can bring the world to its purpose, to its end. So, in Psalms chapter 90, He is talking about His nature as God. He has no beginning and has no end. But in Revelation 22 verse 12, He is talking about His relationship to the world itself. For example, if I'll give you a little analogy. If I were the inventor of the cell phone, I can say, I am the beginning and the end of this cell phone. If I were the inventor. Now, if I say, I am the beginning and the end of this cell phone, I am implying that I was the one who invented it, and I am also the one who will bring it to its proper purpose. I will be the one who will tell you what is its purpose. So, that is also the same with the universe. God is the beginning of the universe because the universe cannot cause its own existence. Now, scientists have already proved that the universe began around 13 billion years ago. In other words, 14 billion years ago, there was no universe yet. There was nothing. And nothing produces nothing. In other words, there is something that can bring nothing to something. And that something is God. So it was God who began the universe. So He is the beginning of the universe. Now, the Bible says that the universe is to be brought by God to its fulfillment. That's in Romans chapter 8, I think in verse 19 to 20. The world is groaning for it to be transformed as the children of God also are transformed in the last day. Meaning it will be brought to perfection together with the children of God on the last day. That is what we call as the New Jerusalem, the new heavens and the new earth. In other words, God will be the end of everything. He will be the one to decide what is the purpose of the universe, what is its complete fulfillment. So, to summarize, Psalm 90 talks about himself. Revelation 22 talks about his relationship with the world. I think that is the answer to your question, Brother Teresa.
All right.
Thank you very much, Brother Lord.
Thank you for that very theological answer to our brother's question. Now, do we still have questions from the audience?
Brad.
Okay. Good evening, our host and
good evening, guest, Brother Ron.
The speaker. I just have a question with regard to tradition. It is very clear in if you look at Matthew chapter 15, verses 3 to 6. So it seems that Jesus is rejecting tradition. So he specifically said, "Why do you transgress the command of God through your tradition?" And in verse 6, he said, "You have nullified the word of God through your tradition." Now, my question is, why does the Catholic Church cling and hold on to tradition when Jesus Christ himself seems to have condemned tradition in this part of Matthew? And just a follow-up question with that. We know that in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16, it says here, "All scripture is inspired by God and is profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be well fitted and adequately equipped for all good work." Keyword is adequately equipped. Why do we need tradition if it says here in the Bible itself that the scriptures is adequate for a man of God to be equipped?
That is a very nice question, Brother Ron. The last one also, the first one was very tricky. We have to know, everybody must know, that the word tradition is used in the Bible in different places, but it does not refer always to a good thing. That is also the same with Colossians chapter 2, verse 8, that some people are following their traditions in contradiction with the Word of God. Now, what is the meaning of the tradition used in Matthew 15, verse 6? Yes, it is clear that in this place, Jesus was rejecting tradition. Now, according to the context, Jesus was arguing with the Pharisees. In this place, the Pharisees were saying that if a person says that all that he has to help for his parents, all things that he has to give to his parents, if all of them had been offered already to the temple, those things are already korban. Meaning that those have already fulfilled what God demands, and therefore if he doesn't help his parents, that is already okay. So Jesus is saying that what you have made as your tradition is in contradiction to the word of God, which says that honor your father and your mother. In other words, Jesus was contrasting the tradition of man and the tradition of God himself. The true tradition is honor your parents, but you have obeyed your own tradition, which is you can dishonor your parents if you already helped the temple by offering. So, in this area, in this place, Jesus was talking of human tradition. What we have talked about a while ago is the apostolic tradition or divine tradition, meaning the revealed truths coming from the mouth of Christ and from God himself, and were taught by the apostles orally. That's very clear in 2 Thessalonians 2, verse 15. So we have to make proper distinctions, human tradition in comparison with divine tradition. Now in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16, you have mentioned that all scripture is inspired of God, and then in verse 17, scripture can help you to accomplish adequately to accomplish every good work. Let me read to you again this verse, starting from verse 15 to get the context. And because, he was writing to Timothy, because from thy infancy thou hast known the holy scriptures, which can instruct thee to salvation, look at the keyword, by the faith which is in Christ Jesus. So, scripture that was talked about by St. Paul was the scripture studied by Timothy ever since his childhood. In other words, it was the Old Testament scripture. Now, if we are to understand verse 16 as meaning, as implying that all scripture, that only scripture is profitable to teaching, and that only scripture is the sole rule of faith, then that implies that the Old Testament is the only basis of doctrine. Because the scripture being referred to in verse 16 was the very scripture studied by Timothy since his childhood. Now, why did St. Paul said in verse 17 that the man of God may be perfect, furnished to every good work, may be adequately equipped for every good work? Yes, the scripture can adequately equip you for every good work if side by side with scripture, you also accept the faith which is in Christ Jesus. And that word faith here, which is in Christ Jesus, is a pregnant word, a very pregnant word. It contains everything that Jesus Christ and the apostles taught. In other words, this word faith contains tradition, contains our obligation to obey the church, to listen to the church. Otherwise, you are not following Christ himself, who said, Matthew 18, verse 17, if he does not listen to the church, let him be to thee as a heathen or a publican, meaning a public sinner and an ostracized member of a community. A Gentile, a pagan, a heathen is somebody who is not part of the people of God. So, scripture can teach you adequately for every good work if it is accepted together with the faith in Christ Jesus. Faith here means belief in all the teachings of Christ. So I think that's my answer.
All right, that's a very effective way of reconciling those contrasting verses in the Holy Bible when it comes to our tradition, and of course the principles of the other groups, which is...
Thank you, Sister Rodeline. And before going to our closing prayer, let me just say some words of apology to our viewers. Please bear with me because I cough every now and then. But at least I tried my best to explain the teachings about the Bible, tradition, and magisterium.
And that concludes our episode for today. And we'd like to thank all our viewers for staying with us for the whole duration of our topic. And we invite all of you to join us in our succeeding episodes as well. And I'd like to thank our guests for this evening, Brother Lord Rolly Urata. And
thank
of course,
you also,
our,
Sister Lawrence.
And we thank the active participation of our audience as well. Now, to conclude and to officially close our episode of Our Catholic Faith for this evening, I'd like to request our guest to lead another prayer.
Okay. Let us all bow down in prayer in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Lord God, thank you for guiding us all throughout this episode. Thank you for sending us your Holy Spirit and touching the hearts of every viewer, every member of the audience today, tonight. Lord God, help them, help us all to keep the Catholic faith until the last moment of our lives. Help us to defend this faith. It is our great honor and privilege and grace that we have this faith and we are defending now your faith. All of this we ask and pray through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.